Okay, good evening, everybody. Thank you for coming. I know there's a few people that are still in line getting food. The food will still be here, I think, served for most of the evening. But so again, good evening. My name is Bob Lorimer, and welcome to the 90th birthday party for a very special man who has made a tremendous impact on the lives of everyone in this room and countless others who are not here with us this evening, my father, Jim Lorimer. My dad has had the most unusual and varied background. He was born in Bristol, PA, 90 years ago yesterday. His father was an electrician, his mother a librarian. He attended Marsville, PA High School, where his focus was on sports. He was captain of the county championship football team, played basketball, and was also county champion in both the 400-yard dash and pole vault. He was elected president of his high school student council. Brought up during the Great Depression, followed by World War II, he was a member of the so-called now Greatest Generation. And following his service in the United States Navy during World War, he went to Ursinus College in Pennsylvania. His naval service caused him to change his focus to getting all A's so that he might go to law school. He graduated from Dickerson School of Law, which is now part of Penn State University. There, he was appointed editor of the school's law review. Directly following law school, he was recruited by the FBI and began his service with the Bureau, specializing in the intelligence field. Three transfers during his Bureau service caused him to pursue employment in the private sector. He took a job with Nationwide Insurance and was soon again transferred to Nationwide. He was soon again transferred to Nationwide here in Columbus, Ohio. He later became Vice President of Government Relations for Nationwide, where he again founded that company's physical fitness program. My father also became involved in coaching and promotion of the Ohio girls track team. That team won the national championship, and he was selected to serve as the chairman of the United States Olympic Committee for Women's Track and Field during the 60s. In 1967, my father became mayor of his home community of Worthington, Ohio, where he has served as mayor and now vice mayor for the past 49 years. My father's promotion, track and field, and the National Weightlifting Championship led him to chairing the 1970 World Weightlifting Championship and Mr. World contest here in Columbus, Ohio, where he invited a young Australian to compete in that event. And the rest of the story will be told here this evening by a number of great friends and very special people. I'd like to start off this evening, if I could, real quick with a video that Governor Kasich sent through, please.
Well, I just want to take a second, Jim. I'm a little bit heartbroken. I'm actually on the West Coast. I'm in Seattle. And if there's anything I didn't want to miss, it's your 90th birthday. But you know what the fact is? You are absolutely the definition of how, you know, these numbers don't mean anything. Ladies and gentlemen, I've known Jim Lorimer for a very, very long time, and of course, his great wife. This is a remarkable man. He has dedicated himself to our community, to our state, to the country, and now, working with my real friend Arnold, he's delivering something to the entire world. You know, Jim, you've always said when I complain or talked about the travel and this and that, he says, don't you love it? Because there's nothing better than being busy and contributing to our culture, to our country, our nation, our community, and of course, to our family. I've always lifted you, and I've always thought so highly of you. You're a great man. You're a great friend. And I wish you the best 90th birthday. And I'm looking forward to coming to more of these parties in the future. I'll see you in the gym, Jim.
We want to thank John for sending that message. It was very nice. So the story of what brings us here all together tonight really began in the 1950s when my father founded the Ohio Girls Track Club. In 2009, my father hosted many of the members of for the 50th anniversary celebration of that team. And we are lucky that many of those women are here with us again tonight, along with Harry McKnight, who is what my father's assistant coach on that team. Please welcome Stell Besseville and other members of the Ohio Girls Track Club.
Good evening. We are members of the Ohio Track Club. Behind me are Sylvia Cox, Laura Dodd, Betty Foster, and Rita White. In our day, we were some of the best athletes in the country, thanks to Mr. James Lorimer. In 1960, Mr. Lorimer started the girls' division of the Ohio Track Club after seeing the American women fail miserably in a dual track meet, the USA versus the then Soviet Union in Philadelphia in 1959. Mr. Lorimer sought a diverse group of girls from Central Ohio. He went to Worthington High School looking for the best female athlete and found Melissa Long, his first recruit. He contacted Nick Barrick, who was head of the Columbus Recreation Department, and other high school PE teachers seeking the best female athletes in Franklin County. Implementing the Lorimer way, he was able to get a chartered plane to take his newly formed team to the 1960 Olympic trials in Corpus Christi, Texas. During the 1960s, prior to the passage of Title IX, no one really cared about girls' athletics in Ohio. There were no opportunities for high school girls to compete in track and field. No city track meet, no district track meet, and certainly no state track meet. During our era, the only way a girl could compete in track and field was through a track club system. Cleveland City had its program funded through its recreation department. Chicago had its program funded through the mayor's office, the Mayor Daley Youth Foundation. Fortunately for us, we had Mr. Lorimer, who had the hustle and skill to get individuals and other groups to provide the resources we needed for a successful team. For example, getting the best coaches in the field events, such as Harry McKnight, who was my high jump coach. Mr. Lorimer coached the runners. Getting permission for us to use the indoor and outdoor facilities at OSU, obtaining financial contributions for travel expenses, soliciting volunteers to drive us to track meets, and contacting local media to promote our sport. Sounds familiar? As female athletes, we just wanted the opportunity to train and compete in track and field, be the best that we could be. Not enough can be said as to how Mr. Lorimer expanded our world. Many of us had rarely traveled out of Ohio. One of our favorite memories is Mr. Lorimer taking the team to a restaurant after every competition in New York City, the top of the sixes. He always ordered Cherry's Jubilee for the team. It was quite impressive to see the waiter serve this flaming exotic dessert at our tables overlooking Midtown Manhattan. Mr. Lorimer was responsible for bringing the 1966 Women's Indoor National Championship to Columbus, Ohio. Of course, it was one of the most organized national meets. As everyone knows, no one can put on a better show than Jim Lorimer, also known as P.T. Barnum. And according to script, our team won the indoor national championships. Sometimes we were teased for being female jocks. As teenage girls, Mr. Lorimer stressed that we were trailblazers, groundbreakers, and independent. He taught us how hard work, being focused, discipline, and of course, how practice, practice, practice can achieve results. It paid off. We applied what we learned in competition on the track to life off of the track. Mr. Lorimer is very proud that all of us received our college degrees. This includes a Harvard-trained lawyer, Sylvia over here. Oh, Sylvia. several PhDs, and five of us with master's degrees. Mr. Lorimer often tells us that there would not have been the Arnold Classic if it had not been for the Ohio Track Club. Can you imagine the world without the Arnold Classic? We are proud to be part of his legacy. Thank you, Mr. Lorimer. You are an incredible man who made a difference in our lives. We cannot imagine the world without you. Happy birthday. We love you. I don't know where he is.
Thank you, Estelle. You and your team will always hold a very special place in my father's heart. My father's coaching of the girls track club led to his involvement in the Amateur Athletic Union, which in the 50s and the 60s oversaw all amateur sports. The AAU asked my father to promote the U.S. Weightlifting Championships in 1967, and then the World Weightlifting Championships and Mr. World Competition 1970. This was all a continuation of my father's love for weightlifting and strength and conditioning, and it's of no consequence that these events have been a huge part in success of the Arnold Sports Festival. Please welcome one of the world leading experts on strength, Terry Todd, for some brief remarks.
Brief remarks. All right. I will do my best. Because I've hooked someone right behind the curtain with a hook, I'm going to start my formal remarks in just a moment. But before I begin my formal remarks, I have a question. It was 16 years ago when Jim and Arnold asked me and Jan if we would design and oversee a strongman competition for the Arnold, what's now the Arnold Sports Festival. We said yes, we would, and so here we are, 16 years later. But the question is this. I have enough bodybuilder in me that I do look at myself in the mirror from time to time. When I do, I look older than I did 16 years ago. However, when I look at the two men who invited me, this would be Jim and Arnold, they don't really seem to me to have changed. If anything, they might even look a bit younger. So, as my students back at the University of Texas might say, what's up with that? You know? So, it ain't right, is what my friend Mark Henry would say. It ain't right. So, while I still have on this professor's hat, I'd like to share a few, this is in Jim's honor, a few lines from his favorite writer. And I'll bet a lot of people in here know who that is, right? It is his favorite writer, Shakespeare. Exactly, William Shakespeare. He, as long as I have known Jim, actually a lot longer than the 16 years, I've been aware of that. I know he goes to that festival in Canada every year. And so I wanted to acknowledge a few lines about one of the subjects that's under discussion tonight. First, I want to denounce, as strenuously as I can, the people who say, and there are many who say this, that the reason that Jim likes William Shakespeare so much is because they were classmates. Classmates. That's just not accurate. I can cite chapter and verse if I have to. Shakespeare was born in a town called Stratford-upon-Avon. Jim, as Bob told you a minute ago, was born in New Jersey. So they were not classmates. I don't want to say too much more about that, but I do want to, as I said, share just a few lines of what the Bard of Avon had to say about aging. This first is from Macbeth. With mirth and laughter, let old age come. From As You Like It, though I look old, I am strong and lusty. 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 From Macbeth, there are things which should accompany old age. Honor, love, and friends. Finally, I'd like to read part of an email I just received from Alton Eliason, a longtime Iron Gamer and an admirer of Jim Lorimer. Alton is a longtime weight trainer, physical culturist, and he is now, and was when he wrote this email to me a few days ago, he is in his 100th year. His wife, Madge, is 101. In just a few months, they're going to celebrate their 80th wedding anniversary. Now, this is a man with some experience in the world. They actually live, still take care of their house, a small organic farm up in Connecticut. And so he heard about this party, Alton did, and he sent me an email, which he wrote himself. He writes lots of emails. He said about Jim, it always makes me happy to see youngsters do well. I've had my eye on Jim since he was a boy, and I believe that he's got what it takes to be successful. And I've got my eye on that Austrian kid too. So, is that under the time limit? Did I make it? Thank you.
Thank you, Terry. I can't believe you really kept it that short. As I mentioned earlier, my father has served as mayor and or vice mayor of Worthington for the past 49 years, which has to be some sort of world record. For the past 2 years, my father has worked with the current mayor of Worthington. Please welcome Scott Holmes.
Good evening. Thank you, Bob, for the introduction. I'm going to try to stay under the time limit. I was told that this was to be in the nature of a roast, and it's difficult for me to think of this in terms of a roast. As Bob mentioned, Jim Lorimer has served the community of Worthington either as a council person, a vice mayor, or mayor, and it's true, for 49 years. No one in the history of the city of Worthington has served longer as a public servant than Jim Lorimer. Now, I have secretly harbored a desire to break Jim's record of 49 years. And it's a mathematical fact that all I have to do to tie Jim's record is to continue to serve until I am at least 109 years old. Although Jim Lorimer was my council person and mayor when I was a kid growing up in Worthington, getting to know Jim over the last 3 years has been very special to me. In my first meeting with Jim after being appointed mayor, Jim made a point to highlight a word that I used in my application for the job, and I'll never forget this. He said, "Scott, you're the only applicant that used the word joy in your application for the job." And then he went on to share firsthand his efforts in starting the Ohio Track Club, and we've heard eloquently from their team tonight. At a time when there was tremendous inequality for women in our country, especially in the world of athletics. And I have to tell the team that when Jim took me into his conference room and I looked at that picture on the wall in his conference room of these then 15-year-old female athletes, that joy word jumped right out at me, because the smile on their faces was one of absolute pure joy. Jim's beginning in this venture with the Ohio Track Club culminated in his partnership with Arnold, which we're obviously going to hear about tonight. 6 continents of promoting sport. Arnold and Jim have a partnership because they have a passion for sport and they appreciate the joy sport brings to life. So that joy word just keeps coming back to me as I've gotten to know Jim. And I am amazed how Jim has done all these things while lovingly and joyfully serving our beautiful community of Worthington for nearly a half century. So Jim, in behalf of the city of Worthington, I congratulate you on your 90th birthday and thank you for all you have given and continue to give with joy to your community, your state, your country, and countries across the world. Congratulations, Jim. It's a privilege to be here.
Thank you, Mayor. Let's see if you can make it to the 109. We wish you do, so. Over the past 16 years, our Arnold Classic event has grown because the city of Columbus has grown. A bigger convention center, new hotels, a vibrant downtown for our guests. There may not have been a bigger cheerleader of our event over the years than this man. Please welcome Mayor Michael B. Coleman.
Good evening, everyone. Good evening. All right, this is a grand celebration, a great birthday, a wonderful day for our city. And Jim Lorimer is a friend of the city of Columbus. He's the father of our city in many ways. He has brought so many people to our city over the years through this great event. And I'm so proud of him. He made such a great difference in this community. I'm grateful. But you know what I'm most grateful of? I'm grateful that he never ran for mayor for the city of Columbus. Thank you, Jim. Where are you? Over here? Thank you, man. I appreciate that so much. Because it would have been no contest. I would have been the shortest term mayor ever. But you've done so much. You know, I got a story, and he doesn't even remember this. It was so long ago. When I was 21 years old, I interviewed with Jim Lorimer when he was with Nationwide. I was a 21-year-old kid in law school. I wanted to intern with Nationwide Insurance. And he was so calm and patient with me, and I was so nervous. I was up in this tall building looking out over the city. And Jim asked me one question. And that question was, do you lift weights? And I was a little skinny kid. I said, no, I do not. He said, good to meet you. There's the door. The truth is, Jim Lorimer is been fantastic for the city of Columbus in so many ways. We love this guy. He helped build this building. He helped build the hotels around it. He's a visionary. He's a doer. And now he's part of this international event called the Arnold, based right here in the city of Columbus. And I want to tell you something, because I know this story. Many times, other cities tried to attract the Arnold to their city, to leave the city of Columbus to their city. Jim said, no, we're keeping it right here in this community. Jim, thank you for all you've done for our city, for this community in so many ways. You made a huge difference to all of us. And the thousands of people you've never met, to all the families you employed, to all the food you put on people's table, to all the shelter you created because all the revenue you brought to our community. Thank you so much. We're so grateful.
Thank you, Mayor. Really nice of you to be here this evening. Another partner for us over the years has been the Columbus Convention Center and the Visitor Bureau, now known as Experience Columbus and the Greater Convention Center. Please welcome the President and CEO of Experience Columbus, Brian Ross, and with Brian is Rhett Reichard of the Franklin County Conventions Bureau Authority.
Good evening, everyone.
Ooh, that was a little loud.
So 90 years. Wow. I think we all can agree, based on what we've seen on the video and what people have said, at 90, Jim, you're still a badass. So I do have a question, though, and Bob, maybe you can help me out with this, that, you know, it is Jim's 90th birthday. I want to know how you convinced them that it's 7 a.m., not 7 p.m. He's on a different continent? Okay. So we're going to keep Jim awake this evening. But anyhow, it started 1970, from what I understand, with the story, Mr. Wild contest here at the Franklin County Veterans Memorial. And Jim hosted this event. By the way, if you want to take a look at it as I have, it's on YouTube. Wide World of Sports. I don't know who remembers that. But I remember watching it in 1970. And Arnold came here and had won Mr. World and had such a wonderful experience with Jim that this was the time where people made commitments on handshakes. And from what I understand, that after that event, when Arnold walked away as the winner of Mr. World in 1970, they made a commitment because of what Jim did for that event, that once Arnold was finished with that professional career, they would start something together. Now, I do want you to understand Jim was 70 in 1970. But anyhow, 46 years later, we have the Arnold Sports Festival. And that is 180,000 people that come into our community every year, over 80 countries, over 20,000 participants as far as competitors. And it represents $51 million into this community's economic impact. So Jim, thank you very much. We appreciate you. Our tourism and hospitality industry, friends that are here this evening, we are all very grateful for what you've done. As Mayor Coleman mentioned, you have raised our profile. We are not only known regionally in Columbus, but we're known nationally and internationally for what you've done in our community. So happy 90th birthday. Thank you, sir.
Good evening. I'm Rhett Reichardt. I'm a treasurer of the Franklin County Convention Authority, and happy birthday, Jim. I'm also lucky enough to be one of those individuals that shook your hand 25 years ago with our family, and you're a man of many words, and you're really a man, an icon in Columbus, but you never had the letter I in icon. Very unselfish person. I'm pleased to represent the Franklin County Convention Authority because these facilities you see here, and this is one of the very first sections that were completed, is just an example of the magnificent $125 million renovation that, Jim, would not be possible without you. So I'd like to give you a round of applause for having this here. Jim's a pioneer. He's a Renaissance man. And quite frankly, you heard it a lot already this evening. He's a very dear friend. This community knows what a big deal this Arnold Festival is to Columbus. This renovation, which you're now in, is 60% complete. It's going to be finished in July. And it would not be possible, I'll repeat myself, would not be possible without the Arnold Sports Festival here in Columbus, Ohio. I'd like to thank you, Jim, and you too, Arnold. You're a big part of it. Thank you very much. All right, so how many of you been in the forklift truck at the back of the festival? Has Jim taken you up? We'll see a show of hands. Who's been in the forklift? You know, that's his thing here. You know, for years, Jim, you've been in that bucket lift truck overlooking the exhibition hall, and it's a heck of a view, isn't it? Well, as part of this $125 million renovation, we built a new show manager's office that's two stories high, so you're able to look over the top. It's even going to have a bigger and better view, so you won't have to get into a bucket truck anymore for the Arnold Festival Trade Show. Let's give you a round. Thank you. So far, no one's been injured in a bucket. But to that end, the board members of the Franklin County Convention Authority, as well as the county commissioners for Franklin County here in Columbus, we felt it should have a name that is second to none. Just like this facility, just like the show manager's office. So on behalf of the board of directors of the Franklin County Convention Center, I'm pleased to announce from tonight forward into perpetuity, the new show manager's office space will be known as the Jim Lorimer show manager's office. That's for you, Jim. You're truly second to none. The city is second to none, and our gratitude, Brian's and the whole rest of the city, Central Ohio, is second to none. So on behalf of the board, happy birthday.
Well, it's quite an honor, Dad. Fantastic. So thank you, Brian and Rhett. This is a tremendous legacy for my father. I also just really want to quickly mention that Don Brown is in the room as well. If Don is here from the Franklin County Commissioner's Office also. So Don, thank you for being here. All right, lighten this up. Another dear friend of my father's, one of the greatest talent agents in the world, known as King of Kink. Please welcome Chuck Harris.
I must say, unaccustomed as I am to public speaking, who the hell is this guy, Jim? I don't even know your last name. Everybody's up here saying nice things to this guy. Before I go any further, I must tell you that I know for a fact Jim is not 90 years of age. No, that's the truth. He hides the fact that he's much older than that. Well, I found out that his Social Security number is 3. That gives you an idea. He gets up every morning and he reads the obituary column. If he's not in it, he goes back to bed. Jim is the type of guy that used to walk long distance every single day after his meal. He still does, but he can't find his way home. Must tell you a great story about Jim and I. I was very lucky to do a show in London for some strange reason, very similar to a show called America's Got Talent. And for whatever the reason was, the Queen of England invited me to have dinner with her, which I thought it was a joke to begin with, but it wasn't. And I mentioned it to Jim. Before I went there, he sent me a cartoon that he spent 3 or 4 weeks to find, and he put it in a nice frame, and it shows a guy walking up to a door with a lady of the evening, and he turns that lady, the guy turns to that lady and says, "Just don't be yourself." I called Jim. He said, "Well, it was perfect for you." I said, "Who did I play, the hooker or the other thing? I don't know." Jim and I have had a relationship which is unbelievable. I have learned more things about life, more things about kindness, more things about people who are very sincere than anybody I've ever met in my entire life. And I don't say that just to make Jim feel good, because I would never want that to happen. But it's true. It's true. He's not here now. Jim, did he go to the bathroom or something? I hope he's gone. I don't want him to hear all these good things. He wanted me to be a member of the FBI one time. I said, "I don't want to be in the Fat Boys Institution." I didn't know what he was talking about. I went to Las Vegas once with him, and he got so old, he crept up to the crap table and crapped and crept away. Now I knew this guy is getting old, but we're still friends regardless. We have a running gag between Jim and I. He always calls me a king because of that article that People Magazine did on me, and I call him the emperor, and he is the emperor. I look for the highest accolade I could throw out to this young man, because to me, Jim Lorimer is a very young man. He's taught me so much. I do not believe he's that much younger than me. But he acts it. He really does. He's such a sincere, wonderful person. I've learned a great deal from him. And Jim, what a pleasure to have me up here to be able to tease with you in front of everybody else, because we do this all the time on the telephone, and nobody gets to hear it. Thank you very much. I can't wait to the 100th birthday. I'll be here, my friend, I promise you. Thank you. Good night, and God bless you.
Well, that was a lot lighter than I thought, but I made him throw away about 50% of his speech, so. Next up is a man familiar to many of you, but possibly unfamiliar to some. Dr. Bob Goldman is a fascinating man, and I can't do him justice with a brief introduction. Please know that Dr. Bob Goldman is one of our biggest supporters, financially and otherwise, and that he founded the International Sports Hall of Fame and has become one of the highlights of our weekend. He also donated and purchased the statue of Arnold that sits outside this building. And it's the building right now is under construction, but hopefully you'll come back and have your pictures taken with it. Please welcome Dr. Bob Goldman.
Well, I'm really especially happy to be here because I was in Florida and they told me all the flights were canceled till Sunday. So I paid the people off, got the last plane out. Otherwise, I was ready to drive from Miami to Chicago, pick up my suit, and then drive here again. So I'm really, really happy to be here. Jim, this was something that I would not miss no matter what. You are one of the real, truly special, amazing people in the world today. What an amazing journey you have had. You're a proud father to great sons and daughters and granddaughters. Your son Bob is doing a tremendous job of continuing on this legacy. 70 years devoted husband to Jean, who has always been at your side and always a pleasure to see. You've been an FBI agent, a football coach, a football star, a track coach, a lawyer, mayor for decades, U.S. Olympic Committee chairman, a 212 inductee along with Arnold Schwarzenegger into the International Sports Hall of Fame, our first class for the International Sports Hall of Fame. We met decades ago in Australia, and I'm sure, Jim, you remember when we met many, many years ago back in the 80s in the Australian Gold Coast for the World Championships, and you were about my age back then, and I knew back then that you were a very special person just because of the manner and how you interacted with people, how comfortable you made them feel, how they just wanted to tell you and learn from you about how they should be and what they should be. Jim, you may not know, was also in the very first, he was one of the first certified personal trainers in the world when I started NASM, National Academy of Sports Medicine. Both Jim and Bob came out and they were in the very first class back in the 80s. So Jim is also a certified personal trainer, for those who aren't aware of it. So he's a father figure to so many, an older brother, a mentor, a confidant, a teacher, and coach. But one of the things that really is so truly remarkable on your journey is being partner and medical advisor, a partner and personal advisor and confidant to one of the most historic figures that the world has known, Arnold Schwarzenegger, and birthing the world's largest sports festivals, which is truly a remarkable feat. What they have created is now global and affecting not thousands, but millions of lives. But most importantly, Jim, what you have done, the respect and the caring and the way that you interact with people has really changed so many lives. It is truly unparalleled. And when I met with you recently, remember a few months back before the sports festival this year, I asked you, like, what advice could you give me? I'm your age now when we first met. What advice could you give me? And you said something very profound. You said the greatest, most amazing time of my life has been these last 25 years. Could you imagine starting the most exciting part of your life at the age of 65, now into your 90s? I mean, how many people can have, when most people are retired, where they stop, you were really just started. I'm honored to be in your presence, in the presence of all these amazing people here today. I wish you a great happy birthday, and thank goodness it's now your legal drinking age. You can go have a drink. Thank you, Jim.
Thank you, Bob. That was very nice. Next up is another one of these guys that, you know, there's just too many things to say about him. He's a great friend. First off, he's the president of the International Federation of Bodybuilding. But Raphael, he leads 189 countries in that. It's the second largest sport federation, only behind track and field. It's a great pleasure that I can welcome Dr. Raphael Santoya. He's also speaking on behalf, he's our partner in Spain. He's also a great friend to all, and he's also speaking on behalf of all the international partners here this evening. Dr. Raphael.
Good evening, dear Jim, Lorimer, family and friends, dear friends in sport and life. It's a great honor and a pleasure to share with you this evening in Columbus, Ohio. This evening, plenty of emotions and feelings. Life is made by moments, and this is a great momentum to keep in our mind forever, the celebration of the 90th birthday of our dear friend, Jim Lorimer. Imagine a sport, how much change. The world, how much change in all these years since the moment in which Jim Lorimer started to work and put his passion in sport and healthy lifestyle. Everything changed. The world changed, the sport changed, the rule changed. He remained the same. He remained in his principles. He remains in his love for sport. And he spanned his life through the life of many others, making them happy. Arnold Sport Festival, with the inspiration of Governor Schwarzenegger, but with the driving force of Jim Lorimer, is something very special now worldwide. It was born in Columbus. It was coming from the inspiration of this great man through previous experience in sport, and is now expanded internationally. I'm very pleased to speak in behalf of our colleagues that are expanding the festival in the six continents. And I am speak as well in behalf of the IFBB family. We are proud to have you, Jim, as our patron. I am speaking as well in behalf of my dear colleagues, Jim Mannion and Albert Busek and Bob Goldman from the International Federation. Life belongs to the people with decision. Always there is a dream, always there is something to do. And all of you can see Jim Lorimer quite peaceful there in that table, enjoying the dinner with all the friends. I can tell you, we know him. He's thinking in a new project, for sure a great project. Thank you, Jim. Many times, people is talking about the Arnold Sport Festival, and sometimes the people is thinking, well, this is like the Olympic or bigger than the Olympic. Olympic is made for glory of a few and stress of many. The Arnold Sport Festival had born for the enjoyments and for the dreams. For the dreams of thousands of youngsters worldwide that through this beautiful project that is a great world reality, make friends, find solidarity in fairness, make their dreams come through. Jim Lorimer, thank you for being as you are. Thank you for all this life lesson, and thank you for many good things to come that we will love to share with you. Thank you very much. Happy birthday.
Thank you very much, Raphael. Another person I do want to say that is in the audience that I do want to just have a quick shout out to, but it's Jim Mannion here in the front. Jim, please just stand and say hi anyhow. He's the president of the professional league for the IFBB, and he leads just a tremendous national physique championship here in the United States. He's the leader in the whole sport. Next up is a person, one of the closest friends of Arnold, and he has been an advisor to us since our early days. He's a very close friend of my father for the past 40 years, and he comes all the way from Germany. Please welcome Albert Busick.
Thank you, Bob. Thank you for the honor to be up here and to speak to all of you. When I drove to the airport in Munich yesterday, I turned the pages in my memory, and there were so many, just one picture after another came in. I just want to share some with you. The first, it was really sympathy at first sight when I met Jim Lorimer 40 years ago. It was just a feeling, you know, this is the man, first sight. Sometimes happens in life, and I'm very fortunate to have known him now for 40 years. I've been an eyewitness of everything what happened here under the leadership of Jim and Arnold, and I missed only two of their shows since 76. Probably the longest hug I ever had in my entire life was exactly 13 years ago as of today. It happened in the early morning of the 8th of October in 2003. Jim and I were standing in a hotel in Los Angeles waiting for an announcement. And the announcement we wanted to hear was, and it came, Arnold Schwarzenegger is elected 38th governor of the state of California. The two of us hugged each other. We jumped around like kids, and thank God it was not the internet time already, that it was really a strange picture probably. But we enjoyed it tremendously, and I never felt so close to my friend Jim Lorimer as in these moments. At custom last night, the officer asked the usual questions. What's the purpose of your trip? And he was a kind of guy like a machine, almost like reminded me of a Terminator or so. So my answer was the birthday of a friend. And he asked on and said, what's your friend doing? And I said, he's organizing the Arnold Sports Festival in Columbus, Ohio, where I'm going to. And he said, don't know. And I said, but you know Arnold Schwarzenegger? Yes. That was it. So even before I entered US, Jim and Arnold were with me already spiritually. So many stories have been told and written about this special friendship between Jim Lorimer and Arnold Schwarzenegger. But to me, it is very, very simple. This friendship has been created by someone higher than us. It was simply meant to be. But today, Jim, it's your day. And you, Jim, are to me, as bloody foreigner, the epitome of the American spirit and what for all of us is the most important thing in life is hope, love, and faith. You are such a great role model in giving hope to so many people all your life. And to me especially, you make me always feel like a kid. So I'm very thankful personally for that feeling, and I have hope for the future if I think of you. You had the courage and the passion to take on so many challenges, and you always had the faith in yourself and in all the members of your many teams. So you proved that faith can truly move mountains. Your mountain is the Arnold Sports Festival. And you are represented now in all six continents. And this unique success story, as Bob Goldman mentioned it before already, started when you turned 50. I mean, many people think already at that age about retiring. But retirement, thank God, is not in your vocabulary. And Jim, millions of fans around the world love it. Which leads me to my credo in life. And I've written this sentence probably thousands of times to many people. Love is bigger than the world we know. You, Jim, gave and received so much love in your life that it seems to be a part of a fairy tale. But thank God, it is so very true. May I ask you all, please, stand for the lady who all her life supported the dreams of her husband, Jim Lorimer. Thank you, Jean, for your true love to Jim. Your love made him and made everything possible. Thank you, Jean. And may I add a little anecdote, if it comes to love. 20 years ago, I had the privilege to attend, it was one of many, the Lorimer family and team dinner on Sunday evening after the Arnold Sports Festival. It was one of these great evenings full of joy and love. Overwhelmed of the feelings, I forgot a simple scarf was hanging around the chair, and I forgot it. Jim drove me to the hotel from Worthington back to Columbus, and in the car, I suddenly found out the scarf is not there. And the scarf was a very special Christmas present from my wife, who passed away several years earlier. And I told Jim the story, and I got off in Columbus at the Hyatt on Capitol, and I told him, please look for the scarf, because I leave early tomorrow, and send it to me. 90 minutes later, the telephone rang in my hotel room. I was almost asleep. And it was Jim. He was waiting for me in the lobby with the scarf. So Jim, because of this act of love to me, I brought you today another scarf. And this scarf is from a famous beer hall in Munich, probably the most famous in the world. It is from the Hofbräuhaus, and it should always remember you. I love you, Jim. Jim, go for the 100. We need you. God bless you. God bless your family. God bless America. Now it is my privilege and honor to introduce a man who doesn't need an introduction at all. Literally speaking, we all know his achievements in so many different areas, and they are, like Bob Goldman already mentioned also, unmatched on our blue planet, period. What stands out above all is this unique friendship over 60 years now to Jim Lorimer. To find the gap between the friendship of Jim and Arnold, you probably have to use a nano measurement. There isn't a gap visible. To me, Arnold represents what St. Paul wrote in his first letter to Timothy, verse 13:13, three remain: love, hope, and faith. But love is the greatest. Please welcome the one and only Arnold.
Wow. Great speech, Albert. Unbelievable. And that's why I love you, because I'm not the only one up here with an accent. This is really great. Well, I think that it's kind of a little bit late to save the evening, but I'm going to try to do my best. What a great, great gathering. Isn't that unbelievable? I mean, I've never been to a birthday party where you have over 300 people. I think it's 368 people that are here today for Jim's 90th birthday, with the mayor here, Mayor Coleman, and the governor giving a speech here. It's unbelievable. Think about that. I mean, it's just too bad that Jim is not alive anymore. I tell you, What changes have taken place? Actually, you know, it's great to have him still alive. But I mean, what great changes have taken place here? I mean, I remember that just 30 years ago, we celebrated Jim's birthday, and then there was a stripper that was dressed as a nurse jumping out of the birthday cake. Remember that? Those that were here. Well, today, it would be a paramedic with a defibrillator jumping out of the cake. So things have changed. I have to admit that. But Jim, you are so old. It is really amazing. I mean, your phone number is 5. So this just shows you. But Jim is so old, he's the only person that actually has a Bible that is personally signed to him by Jesus. Think about that. Jim, you're so old that whenever we talk to you about illegal aliens, you still think it's the British. but that's okay. Now, Jim has been my partner for the last 40 years. We split the money on a friendly handshake. Well, just like my divorce. But anyway, this is besides the point. Jim, we love your time that you spent in the FBI. I mean, you've worked right under J. Edgar Hoover. And what kind of a great relationship you had with Hoover. The only uncomfortable and kind of awkward situation that happened one time was at the party, when Jean, your wife, and J. Edgar Hoover ended up appearing with the same kind of a dress. So that was kind of a little bit uncomfortable. Don't you admit that, Jim? Well, what can I tell you? I mean, Bob told me to roast a little bit before I give my speech. Bob, where is Bob? Bob, where are you? You see, he disappeared all of a sudden. I just wanted to tell Bob that he shouldn't feel guilty or bad that he's fat, because the apple doesn't fall far from the tree. But anyway, it's just a joke. Bob told you, now listen, anything that is bad, Bob wrote it. Okay, I just want you to know, and all the good jokes are mine. Just want to make sure that you understand that. But anyway, all jokes aside, the bottom line is it is great to have Mayor Coleman here and to have this great speech from Governor Kasich, who is a great, great friend. And both of them have been so supportive to the Arnold's Classic. And I'm here today with great, great pleasure because Jim is one of my greatest friends and my best friends. And we met in 1970, and the 2 hours after we met in 1970, he made me a winner. Think about that. I won the Mr. World competition. And it was the best organized competition I've ever been to. And this is why I said to Jim, Jim, we got to become partners. When I retire from bodybuilding, you and I, we should organize bodybuilding competitions together. And that's what we have done from 1976 on. So we've been doing this now for 40 years. But during that time, we have created a kind of a friendship unlike anything else. He has become kind of a father figure to me, a confidant, a mentor. And what is so great about Jim, and I think we all heard all the things that he has done for the community, how greatly he has contributed to the community, and how greatly he has communicated, kind of contributed to the city of Columbus and the state of Ohio, to this country and the whole world now with the Arnold Classic. I mean, everything that he does, he never ever thinks about himself. He's the most selfless individual that I've ever met. It's never about he wanting to get credit. He's always behind the scene, and he always is the kind of a person that wants to lift up everyone else. It doesn't matter if it is the track and field team, or if it is the bodybuilders or the strongmen, or the other 56 different sports that are coming here to Columbus, Ohio. He wants to lift and elevate everyone up. And this is why I have today as a birthday gift here an eagle. I want to show you, take this off. This is a beautifully sculpted eagle. And the reason for this eagle is because it's symbolic. Because you, Jim, make everyone soar like an eagle. And we all know that eagles are a high altitude bird. You know, the turkey is a low altitude bird, the buzzard is a medium altitude bird, but the eagle is a high altitude bird. But what makes the eagle soar so high is because of the wind that carries its wings. Well, Jim Lorimer is the wind for everybody. He is the one that is lifting up everybody. And he has lifted me up for the last 46 years. It doesn't matter if it is in bodybuilding or with the Arnold's Classic, or if it is when we joined the President's Council on Physical Fitness, where he walked into the White House and we said we want to go do the great American workout in front of the South Lawn of the White House. And 8 lawyers were sitting there and said, it's impossible, you can't do that. Little did they know who they were dealing with, because Jim was sitting right by my side. And within an hour, he convinced them that this is the right thing to do. And President Bush okayed it. And we had the great American workout every year under President Bush. Or if it is in my acting career, reading scripts for me and giving me advice, or sitting in a jacuzzi at his house and giving me advice about should I get married or not, should I create a family or not. Or if it is when I ran for governor of the state of California, I had to call him. He was the only one in the world that knew that I'm going to run. I couldn't tell anyone because everyone immediately leaks to the press. But I knew that I could call him and talk to him about it, and he gave me great, sound advice. And I ran for governor. So it doesn't really matter what I did. Jim Lorimer was always there, or was always a great partner, a support system, and lifting me up, and lifting me up, and lifting me up. And this is why, Jim, I'm so honored to be here today. I'm so honored to have had this 46-year relationship with you, this friendship. And so I want you to come up now and to receive this birthday gift for your 90th birthday, this eagle. Please give him a big, big hand, and let's all sing happy birthday. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Jim. Happy birthday to you. Bravo. Thank you, thank you.
Oh, that's great.
Thank you.
Can you imagine, ladies and gentlemen, following Arnold on any rostrum? And I've had to do that a number of times. I want to welcome and thank each and all of you for being here this evening. I also want to thank and greatly appreciate my distinguished friends who said so many kind things. What can you say on your 90th birthday that might have meaning to more than 350 friends and family, some of whom have come from around the world to wish you a happy birthday? While we've always said we have to do better than our previous best, it would not be possible for you to honor me more than you have this evening. Thank you, thank you, thank you from a most appreciative and very lucky 90-year-old man. The first 90 have been very great. The fact is, I don't feel 90. In fact, I usually don't feel anything until around noon each day, when I feel ready for my nap. And then I have another challenge. If I'm at work, Lucy says, "Don't you think you should go home and rest?" And if I'm home, my wife says, "Don't you have something to do at work?" So I'm not always sure where I'm supposed to be. Probably the only person who wishes to be 90 is an 89-year-old. But there are some advantages. As far as I know, I am the only person still standing from the 1944 Morrisville High School graduating class. It is therefore very easy to schedule high school reunions. Wherever I am, there is a reunion. And I thank you all for being here this evening to participate in my 72nd high school class reunion. I am no longer concerned about peer pressure. From the vantage point of 9 decades of life experience, I want to share a few thoughts on your prospects for reaching age 90 and beyond. Are there things that you might do to improve those prospects? How can you make each age and year more meaningful and enjoyable than the last? I'd like to suggest some answers to those questions. I sent an email to Arnold on his recent 69th birthday, expressing the wish that I might be 69 again, and also sharing that the last 25 years of my life, since my retirement from Nationwide at age 65, have been the best, the most challenging and rewarding of all the years of my life. The fact is, I have been feeling that way about each new stage of life. The chances you will live to age 90 and beyond are very promising. Actuaries tell us that when I was born in 1926, my life expectancy was 56. Today, life expectancy in the developed countries of the world has reached 80 and beyond. Demographers tell us that one half of children born in our country in this century will live to be 100 and beyond. The word beyond should be interesting to you, as we also hear the word amortal being used more and more. Just as lifespans have nearly doubled during my lifetime, it is expected that they will double again during the lifetime of many in this room. Advances in high-tech healthcare, genetic engineering, cyborg enhancement, bionics, and the like pretend that few people will die of old age in the future. More will die from accidents and misdeeds of others than from aging. Chronological ages of 150 years will be reached. The promise that many in this room this evening will see that happen should inspire and motivate you to take full advantage of this century plus opportunity. Keep in mind that when I was born in 1926, there were no airlines. Cars could travel only a few miles on no highways. There was no thought of TV. Silent movies were all that we knew. We had ice boxes, not refrigerators, in homes. There was no space travel, no handhelds, no cloud, no cyber world. It would have taken Tony Doherty here from Australia this evening, months to come to Columbus. He is here in less than a day. We know in the near future that time travel will be cut in half, and we will surely colonize Mars. As we have moved from the industrial age to the age of technology, we have witnessed that technology builds on technology. The future promises unbelievable change. We do know we will be seeing more driverless and flying cars, increased space travel, conquering of most diseases. The potential for change exceeds our knowledge and imagination at this time. You, and most certainly your children, will be there to live in this fantastic new world. What can you do to increase the certainty that you will reach 90 and beyond? Can each new stage of life be more fulfilling and meaningful than the last? The view that genetics plays an important role in our prospects for longevity is being viewed with less and less predictive importance. My brother and his family here from Louisville this evening had a father and a grandfather who lived into their 90s. Our mother and grandmothers died much earlier. The best test and promise of long life is how you live that life. We know if you don't use it, you lose it. And that is a most important physical and mental truth. Knowing the strong sports orientation of those here this evening, I'm certain that you are very physically active, working out or competing. You eat sensibly, you don't smoke, and make certain that you challenge yourself mentally. You must continually monitor your health. We have an entire table here this evening of great doctors who I've encouraged to have as part of their life mission to keep me above ground. I also have another table of lawyers whose mission is to keep me out of trouble. One secret of long life is to get things that can be fixed and fix them immediately. While physical health is important, I'd like to share a couple of thoughts on how we might live our life so that we feel each new age, each new stage is the best. They are the thoughts that have guided me. The longer I live, the more strongly I come to believe that there are some basic approaches to life that make all the difference for us and for those we love. They can contribute more to our happiness and chances of success than education, money, appearance, or skill. It is something we can control, and it controls how you see the world and how the world sees you. That enhancing life factor is your attitude. Your attitude. I have a small plaque on my desk at home that says, "Attitude is everything." While certainly not everything, Your attitude can and does make a very great difference in your life. My wife of 67 years, Jean, who keeps me justifiably humble, tells me she does not feel that I have a negative bone in my body. Now, whether that is true or not, I will share a story about a friend who is a prime example in this field. A little while back, Time magazine was doing a cover story on Arnold. The feature writer was a woman who called me from New York. We talked for nearly an hour, and it was a very insightful interview. The final question she asked me was, what is the one thing about Arnold that distinguishes him from anyone you've ever known? I told her it was his capacity for enjoyment. Most everything he does, he enjoys. Not hedonistic pleasure, but genuine enjoyment. It is an attitude of mind. After that phone interview, I called Arnold and told him about the interview and the woman's questions. And he said, "That's very interesting. She asked me what one word I would use to describe myself." And he said, "I said, joy, joy." Now here is a man who defines himself in terms of joy. That attitude, that approach to life, comes through to all of us and helps make Arnold the most special man that he is. Let me share another brief story and insight about Arnold. A few months ago, Arnold was invited to Paris to be a keynote speaker at a meeting of 191 heads of nations at the International Symposium on the subject of world climate change. He is recognized worldwide in this increasingly important field. But then he came directly from that Paris meeting to Worthington, Ohio, where he attended and spoke at a meeting of the Worthington City Council as I was being sworn in for the 24th time as Vice Mayor of Worthington. Think of that. A man goes from Paris, the meeting of the heads of nations, to witness a friend's swearing out in a town of Ohio. That is a very special man and most special friend. Two important subsets of attitude involve how to deal with adversity and worry. You can be sure that life will deliver you some challenges, some curveballs. At age 75, I was working out daily, playing tennis, and taking my wife for evening walks. A problem was spinal stenosis resulted in three operations beginning in the year 2000. For the past 15 years, I have been able to walk only about 30 yards before low back pain requires that I sit down. For a person who always felt he could run forever, that was a very limiting problem. But then I remembered, as I would like you to remember, an attitudinal life lesson I learned from President Franklin Roosevelt. Here was a man who was elected four times as President of the United States, who led our country through a Great Depression and the Second World War in his mid-30s, just prior to his plans to run for governor of New York. He was badly stricken by polio. From age 39, he could not walk and could stand only with metal braces on his legs. He became despondent about life. But then a friend told him, "You do not have to be a gymnast to be governor of New York." He took that message to heart and then served two terms as governor of New York and was elected president of the United States four terms. He could not walk and could barely stand. I knew I did not have to be a gymnast to help run the Arnold Sports Festival or to serve my community. Worry can be another attitude problem. The realistic thought and question should be for yourselves, can I actually do something about this situation or not? 95% of what we worry about never happens. We can be concerned about whether it is Hillary or Donald, and we should vote, but we should not worry or lose sleep over it. The most enriching of all life's experiences is the friendships, partners, and love we share throughout life. This evening is a perfect example of how lives come together over time to create human bonds and friendships that are most valuable and cherished of all life's experiences. 75 years ago, this month of October, there was a Halloween party involving the Morrisville, Pennsylvania high school football team. A game was played called Wink, Wink, during which the girls stood in a circle surrounding the boys sitting in the center of that circle. If a girl winked at a boy and he winked back, they had to kiss. That was the luckiest day and the greatest thing that ever happened in my life. I found and held on to my life's partner, the 14-year-old girl who winked at the 15-year-old boy that evening. Having a loving, caring, sharing, beautiful life partner can and did make all the difference in my life. One friend of mine who heard that story told me he learned an important lesson. Don't wink at Jim Lorimer. To my always more beautiful life partner, to our other partners in life, to my wonderful family, four generations are here this evening, to our friends from around the world, we still have some work to do, more joy and great experiences, and I'm sure the best is yet to be. Thank you.
Wow, thank you, Dad. That was amazing. You know, what a great speechwriter, isn't he, guys? Now, I just need to thank a few people, special individuals and organizations that helped tonight. Live Technologies, because all these people donated times and service to what we did, but Live Technology for all this stage and sound and light and everything. So, Greater Columbus Convention Center for this room this evening. I want to thank Craig Liston, Joe Shaw, John Page for donating this tonight. Soon you're going to hear from the full swing band, and I hope you guys stay in to listen to what they have to do. They have a swing thing, and so we certainly hope you stay for that. Liz Green in our office, who really put this evening together, so. Again, Brian Ross, an experienced Columbus, for donating the centerpieces this evening. Rhett Reichert, the Reichert Automotive Group, for donating. On all the tables, there's a little cube DVD, and they put all the slideshow of data up on that thing. And long, also, there's about a 20-minute video at the end of it that Dad talks about how he started in this, so that gift came from them. Of course, Think Patent, Dave Stewart, because they did all the design of the invitations and the quote cards that are on the tables this evening. They printed everything. Excel Decorators and Terry Walburn for everything they do. Buckland and Gillespie, Kevin and Bertian for the designing of all the quote cards and all the stuff that helped go into this evening. I'd also like to thank the international partners from around the world who have joined us tonight from 6 continents, and all the great friends that have come from around the world to be here this evening. Finally, on behalf of our family, my brother Jeff, my sister Kathy, my mother, and the rest of the family here tonight, thank you again for being here. Thank you for coming and sharing this special day with us. Again, Arnold took a little bit of a step away from us on this, but as we prepare to sing Happy Birthday to My Father, we want to welcome an international jump rope champion, Tori Boggs, to give us a quick performance of what she does. Thank you, Tori. Lights.
Thank you.
Thank you, Tori. That was amazing. Even though Arnold took that away from us once, we want to go back to this. Please join us one more time with a full swing band honoring and singing Happy Birthday to Jim Lorimer.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Jim. Happy birthday to you.
Snapchatting that for 90-year-olds are a pretty good thing, isn't it? So, the thing will go viral, so we all know.